welcome to the October edition of Bedford Common. Yeah. That's a throwback to Ron Cordes, who really took October seriously. Although, if you stick around, you'll see some haunted happenings, as well as flavors of Bedford. My name is Julie Turner. My co-host is...
Ralph Hammond.
There you go. And we are here to talk government in Bedford. We have with us Margot Fleischman, representing the selectmen, Amy Lloyd, chair of the planning board, Stephen Steele, chair of the finance committee, and school committee chair Mike McAllister. So, October, what's going on? Who wants to start? All right, Steve, it's you.
What we're doing at this point is we're preparing for a special town meeting. What we usually do is look at our financial models, revalidate the revenue estimates, revalidate the expense estimates, and potentially look at funding some additional capital articles, putting some additional money to stabilization funds and reserve funds. So we're kind of looking at all the estimates and expenses and seeing how we can kind of fit the round peg into the square hole.
Okay, fair enough. Well, and this is because when town meeting happens in the spring, you don't have all the numbers that you need and things change.
Correct. A perfect example is with the Hanscom funding, the $500,000 that we actually had to pull some capital articles out.
Yeah.
There's a better chance we're going to receive that. There's no guarantee till it's in the bank, so we don't want to count it till it's in the bank, but I think we can probably change some of our financial models as a result of that and be probably closer to accurate than we were in the spring.
So. And you're looking to come out right on the money.
Well, we always come out on the money. It's just a matter. It's just a matter of what we do with the money we have.
Okay.
So there's a lot of moving pieces. We're looking at capital articles that we had to delay some things in the spring that we could potentially relook at now. We probably may put some more money into stabilization, other reserve accounts that we can keep a rainy day fund.
So this is, we're talking about the first Wednesday in October when you're first seeing this, and then town meeting will be on?
I don't recall the date. It's
November 2nd.
So finish with Halloween, get all your candy digested, and then come to town meeting, or bring some candy to town
Bring candy to town
there you go.
Absolutely.
So are you expecting any surprises other than the...
No, I mean, I think we've seen special town meeting have more articles than they have in the past, but I think that's just a revalidation of estimates and projections, yeah. And I think it's always a good thing to do that.
Margot, do you have any idea of what some of the articles will be?
Sure, absolutely. We actually just saw a draft warrant, and I can tell you a little bit about what's going to be on it, and then to fill in some more details, I'm sure that Amy will have some things to share from the planning board, because some of these things cross over our jurisdictions. So there is a petitioner's article to change the zoning for the Page Place condominiums, the former school, as people know, on Page Road, mm-hmm. 75 Page Road. They're going to come before the town and asking for some alterations. There'll be a public hearing, but probably by the time people see this show, the public hearing will already have happened. And but the planning board and the selectmen are going to have an opportunity to scrutinize that plan and to weigh in on whether or not we think it's a good idea. But ultimately, it does have to go to town meeting. Another validating kind of article is that we are putting a complete streets article on the town warrant. This is just the acceptance of a state statute creating complete streets, which means streets that are designed for all users, bikes, pedestrians, cars, trucks, everybody having access to the streets. And by accepting the Mass General Law, that just gives us the opportunity to implement a complete streets policy. So it's one of those things where you go to town meeting, you ask for permission to accept the law, and then you work on the policy and you accept the policy afterwards.
So the policy would maybe come around in April?
The policy just needs to be adopted by the selectmen. The idea is that we'll probably have a pretty good idea of the draft of the policy that we're going to be suggesting at the time of town meeting, but it will not have been adopted yet, and there might be some tweaks that are made. Okay. So that's a work in progress. Another thing that we come before the town to ask every year is to tell us again if we're going to stay in the community preservation program. I wasn't a selectman at the time, but the selectmen made the promise to town meeting voters back in the first year of community preservation that we would come back annually and just reaffirm the surcharge. The 3% that we voluntarily put on our surcharge on our property taxes is matched every year by the state. The state matches have varied. For the first 7 years of the program, they were 100% match. For every dollar we raised, we received a dollar from the state. As the program became more popular
and more towns
joined, and particularly there were some changes in the legislation that allowed larger cities to join, and that hadn't been the case in the past. The pie has not grown as much as the number of people trying to get a piece of it. So the matches have come down a little bit through the years. We had 57%, and then we went down to 30%, and now we're estimating about 20%. We won't know the final numbers until after town meeting. They will give us those numbers in the middle of November. But these are projects that the town really needs to do. We've been working, community preservation has been working with capital expenditures to identify real priority projects that are also happen to be capital community preservation eligible for funding. And so we're trying to work creatively to make sure that the projects are of good value to the town, and all the projects that the town does are matched by the state funds, which this year, as I said, we're estimating at 20%. Although it may wind up being a little higher than that, but we don't want to overestimate their match and then wind up having problems.
A little extra bang for the buck is always good.
Yeah. So we'll also pass the CPA budget again, sort of like what Steve said. There'll be some minor adjustments, some actuals. We haven't gone out to bonding for one of our articles that we passed last year, so we're going to adjust the bonding authorization just so that it's more appropriate, and some minor adjustments to the CPA budget. So that will be another article to look for. One other article that the selectmen are considering at this time is putting on an article to fund the study, of where we might put a historical museum in town. There's been a museum study committee that has presented a report to the selectmen that made some suggestions of 5 potential locations, and now we need to dig a little bit deeper and find out how much that would cost and what it would entail to convert some town-owned space or acquire some new space into an appropriate location for a town museum for all of the artifacts and documents that the town possesses that need to be kept safe. They need to be protected from fire and water damage and hopefully made more accessible to members of the public who want to learn about the town, do research, children learning in schools. So educational programs would be a great component of it. So that is something that may appear on the warrant. The selectmen have not made that final determination, and we'll close the warrant at the beginning of October, and then you will know for sure when you get it in the mail what we decided.
Of those 5 options, is it 5 options still open, or have they narrowed it down to 1 or 2?
No, they started with a larger list, a much more comprehensive list, and narrowed it down to 5. They called them A-list and B-list. So there's an A-list of 5, and then there's a B-list that would also be possible, but are not nearly as ideal as the 5, in the opinion of the Museum Study Committee, as the 5 top choices that they would like the town to spend some time investigating.
Sounds good.
So that's everything I have to say for town meeting, and I'd be happy to move on to some other subjects if you're interested.
Of course we're interested. That's what we're here for.
So it's exciting news from the Bedford Fire Department that we are launching our paramedic service this month. Those of you who were at town meeting a little while ago will remember that this was something that we took some several steps towards, and this year there have been 3 new paramedic firefighters trained. There's one coming soon. There's one already on the department, so we'll have 5 trained paramedics, and eventually that number will grow to 8. In the meantime, we still get backup from Armstrong Ambulance, but we are moving towards having our own very responsive advanced life support services coming right out of the Bedford Fire Department. So that is an important and exciting change. Certainly there was concern with the response times that we were getting for our ambulance service, and this will make a big difference, I think, to people who require ambulance service in town. And certainly we want to give them the best quality and fastest service that we can to get people to the medical care that they need. So that's also something, actually in town meeting we'll make a little tweak to the ambulance enterprise budget, because now we do have some actuals now that we're starting to really launch the service. So Other than that, I have just a little update about the Bedford Marketplace. Two buildings will be demolished this month.
The two front buildings.
Okay. The new building on the left of the marketplace is just about done. The addition next to Marshall's is also nearing completion. That's where the Red Heat Tavern and the Lincoln Liquors will be relocated. And as you, people who have been to the marketplace recently will see that there are trailers there for both the post office will be moving into the trailer, and the Bank of America has a trailer there. So that there's some temporary quarters. And speaking of temporary quarters, anyone been to town hall recently?
That's so, in the trailer too.
If you've been to town hall, you'll see that the renovations are just about to start. Most of the departments have already located into a big set of cubicles that are in the multi-purpose room. If you open that door and look inside, that's where all of our town employees will be working. For 10 to 12 weeks, we anticipate that.
What about the selectmen's meeting room? Will that?
The meeting room will still be accessible. Okay. That is not going to be affected, but it's all the offices and all of the, everybody who works in the town hall building is being affected.
All three floors?
I believe so.
Wow.
But certainly all of the offices on the second floor and town manager's office, everybody's moving into the multi-purpose room, and that will go until the project, that portion of the project is complete. Then they will move everybody out of the multi-purpose room and work on the lighting and the acoustics. And I'm sure everyone is really delighted that the next time we have a big public meeting in the multi-purpose room, you might be able to hear people speak, and it won't look like such a dungeon because we'll get rid of all of those really old, outdated fluorescent lights, put in some nice lighting.
Oh, yay.
So that'll be good. And then the last phase of the town hall renovation, it's a mechanical engineering and plumbing. The last phase is the elevator. So those are the three phases. The first one, they're doing all of the HVAC and all of the sort of the guts of it are getting done now. Then the multi-purpose room, then the elevator. And then it'll be done. It's going to be very quick.
And very special, I would guess.
Well, you know, we've taken good care of that building. If you look at other towns, they don't all necessarily have you know, such a nice town hall building, and of course it was also converted from a school, as you know, Ralph.
I got there.
and this will help it work better. If those of you who go to meetings a lot, as many of us do, could testify that the temperature can be very erratic, the sound of the air handler can be very disruptive, and so also because we want it to be more energy efficient. We've committed to being a green community.
Right.
And we need to bring our energy consumption down. This, all the electronic controls and ability to adjust as needed the temperature and the functioning of the systems will help us save money and energy.
Great.
That's it.
Good.
Fantastic. So how does the planning board fit into all of that, Amy?
Well, Margaret was talking about the
Page
Place. Yeah,
yes.
And that's the only zoning initiative that's coming before this town meeting. We anticipate some significant zoning initiatives and changes to come before the annual town meeting. It's important to remember that the Page Place is a petitioner's amendment article. The planning board is the body through which all zoning bylaw changes have to come through. We're the board that holds the public hearing for the public to come and comment, but And we are giving our input because we anticipate that we will make a decision whether or not we approve it, or you know, if we think that it is a worthy project or not, and we will give that recommendation at town meeting. But ultimately, it's not the planning board's initiative. So this is a little bit unusual, a little different than what normal bylaw changes, how they happen. But speaking of development...
Well, can we just touch one piece?
Of course.
I'm on the Trails Committee, and I'm curious, is that trail going to go through? Is there any discussion on that?
We cannot require them to provide public access because it's seen as a taking, essentially.
Right.
Or it's so close as to a taking that it's not really kosher. However, we are heavily recommending there be a purpose statement added to the beginning of this bylaw change that makes it very, very clear what the priorities of the town are in school conversions. And one of those priorities is connectivity, public access, right, public view sheds, those sorts of things. The other thing I think that's important to remember with this bylaw is that in reality, it's really going to only apply to one property, this property only, even though potentially it could apply to the other school properties. In practice, Bedford doesn't have other land to build schools. I cannot see that the town would let go of any more schools, and I've heard some commentary that there's some regret that this one was let go 35 or so years ago. And so we're really just talking about this piece of property. The other thing about this as well is, even on the completely remote chance that some other school is let go, this applies only to the conversion of the building. If a developer were to buy a school and tear it down to build something, this is off the table, and it reverts back to conventional subdivision, planned residential development, cluster, regular bylaws. So it's a pretty unusual situation, not one I think we'll see again in a long time, anything like that. But speaking of development, I have the hot off the presses today, and boy, development is booming. And I think we've got a lot of stuff, a fair amount over across Route 3, the Bedford Business Park. I never can remember which name is which. The ones that are right at the beginning of Crosby Drive on the left, across from MITRE, they have come before the selectmen to discontinue this little tiny piece of road that I hadn't realized was still a public street. I thought it was their driveway, but it turns out that old piece of road.
Going into the old salt shed?
Yes. Yes.
Really? That's a town
road? Yes, that was a portion of that.
It
was still a town road.
It used to cross Route 3. Before Route 3 was Route 3.
Yeah.
That was a while ago.
Yeah. But, and discontinuance simply means that the town says, it's okay, you can take it, you're responsible now.
So that's the original Burlington Road then.
Is it really?
Yeah.
But the real news is all the residential development, and I think that this touches on something that Mike is going to talk about, and that is the rise in the enrollment at the schools. And we've got a number of residential developments in the pipeline. Some are, we're seeing in our next meeting as public hearings, so they're very far along. Some are just in the talking to the staff and kind of getting the lay of the land. But there are six potential developments that have multiple units and with a potential of about 100 total units in these six different developments, which is quite a lot. I think it's important that everybody remember that we are seeing a development boom at its apex here. Mm-hmm. The developers are rushing to take advantage of favorable financing, trying to put units wherever they can, tuck them into every backyard if they could do it. Although there have been no studies done here in Bedford, there have been studies done in various places over various years around the country. And many studies show that large single family houses tend to generate the most children. A number of the developments that we're looking at are what we call PRDs, planned residential developments, that we are pushing hard to have smaller units. Including some cottage housing. You've heard me beat the drum before on cottage housing.
Yeah.
And those are particularly appealing to empty nesters because they typically have first floor master suites and smaller sizes so that they're easier to take care of. So we tend to encourage strongly the developers to look outside the traditional large single family house. We've got many of those, but we don't have smaller houses that cater to other demographics in town. So we will continue to, do our due diligence and work very hard to, shape the developments that come before us and try to serve the long-term interests of the community.
Thank you for that, because we want it to be good. So, Mike, how many new kids are there in Bedford this year?
There's a lot.
How many?
In
One of the places we look at always is kindergarten. How many seniors are we graduating? How many kindergartners are we bringing in? We're always looking at those numbers. And if you remember last year, it was over 200 kindergartners, which is quite a surprise. In the previous years, it was around those numbers. Currently, it's 186. We're expecting to be about 192 by usually to the state we report October 1st. So those are still quite higher than we've traditionally had. So one of the things that we did last year and we started in the springtime is commissioning an enrollment study. And that's a big piece of what the school committee's been focused on. We actually went to the selectmen the other day and presented to them. We've been discussing with FinCom. Mm-hmm. One of the big pieces for us is understanding that while it's currently a school challenge, it really is a whole town challenge. And so we're trying to let everyone know about our results. I know John, our superintendent, is going to be writing an article for the Citizen and also in the Minuteman, really just trying to get the word out about what the raw numbers look like. So a couple of pieces. I think the thing to remember about the enrollment study is it's different than previous enrollment studies. It's a pretty thorough process. They did a lot of talk. They did looking at a lot of residential building projects, for example. They talked to realtors. So it's more than just sort of a data look. Typically, enrollment studies look at census data. And this was a little bit more thorough, and they looked at a lot of data points. A couple of the highlights, I think, are that Bedford is growing at a rate of 5.8% since 2000. Middlesex County, as people know, is a growing county. Middlesex County is growing at around 2.6%. So the rate of growth in Bedford is really significantly higher than Middlesex County. Specific to those 2 points, the Donahue Center, which is out of Massachusetts, University of Massachusetts, talks about the number of residents under 18 going up and relates that because the cohort of 25 to 44-year-olds, so mostly people who are about to have children or having children, will increase about 20.5% by the year 2020. So there's a really huge growing, and it's very clearly related to the housing, the housing development and people moving in and things like that. So, that's a great thing too, right? It's a great thing. There's a good reason why families are moving into Bedford. It's why we're all here. So I think the schools are a big draw for people. Most of the increase I think we see are families moving into Bedford. It's not that, families are getting larger or it's really mostly residential construction projects, I think, has a big influence on that. And so there is an enrollment bubble at Davis currently. We have 2 modulars. The plan was to get a 3rd modular, but sort of the finances didn't work out like that. So we currently have 2, and the class sizes are a little higher than we would like. Bedford does, I think, a really nice job of keeping class sizes small, but they're a little higher than we would like.
What is the class size at?
So they're around 20 to 21. Okay. Which is really nice. You know, the range we're looking at is 18 to 22. And so I think that Bedford, the town and the school committee has done a good job of putting that class size priority. When I was here last week, we talked about the ratings that the Bedford Public Schools are getting. Yeah. And a big piece of that is the way we've been able to control our class size numbers, things like that.
We were pushing 23 at one point, and it was pretty scary. So
yeah, there's a lot of communities that are really, it feels full. A school feels very full, and a classroom feels very, very full when you get to those mid to high 20s. So I think that we're seeing a bubble come through. It's in Davis now. It's entering Lane. And then to John Glenn and the high school, I think the thing to remember about that is even though it will move through the district, by the year or whatever it is, 2025 or whatever it is, the number that gets left in its wake is still higher than it was. So it's not just a straight bubble where it comes up and goes back to the previous rates. The bubble will come through and the rate will still be higher. So overall, the trend is that the district's growing and more students are certainly in the schools. So with that, a big piece of what we're looking at is do we need additions? So we talked about, we put in statements of interest to the Massachusetts School Building Authority for Davis Lane and John Glenn Middle School, just because we know the bubble's coming. The priority is really Lane, because that bubble's about to enter there. Mm-hmm. We have a little bit of increased capacity with 2 modulars at Davis, so we're surviving there. And since the Lane is like the school that's the most likely to see the next bubble, that's where we've really prioritized that.
Well, and there are a surprisingly large number of, to my mind, a surprisingly large number of students at Lane already. It's what, 500 or
there are. No, it's definitely high. Yeah. I think that they have currently the capacity, but I think if we look at that bubble, we're about to be, two to three classrooms too short. So there was the Mass School Building Authority visited all 3 of the schools this week, and they came and did site visits. Their senior team came out in December. There's currently 97 applications before the Mass School Building Authority, and they'll approve anywhere from 17 to 19. So really, you are sort of at the will of the MSBA, but also in comparison to who happens to be applying that year. So I think that we put in statements of interest, and we've certainly done due diligence meeting their senior team, and we're going to see what they come up with. The December is the next date for that. That's when they really announce what can be expected. And we'll know where we stand. Either they ask us, either they accept it, or they accept part of them, maybe Lane, maybe instead of Davis, or they reject it and ask us to apply another year. And so that would be hard, because while the Mass Building Authority might not approve it, we know the kids are still here. And so we're talking with FinCom and with Selectmen about what is Plan B? What are the different options we have? And this is something Steve and I have been talking about, is what are the different scenarios that the schools might play out? Modulars versus permanent additions. What are the costs? What are the deadlines? What's the funding source? So we're trying to be as thorough as we can with that.
On that study, was there a growth pattern during the year, or does it kind of decline as they grow?
You mean from September to June?
Yes.
So, yeah, so I think we're seeing, you know, we're seeing a lot of summer enrollments, mm-hmm. which is pretty common. We're seeing a lot of more enrollments in KN1. During the year, we don't have a lot of transients. I think our retention's pretty high of students, so we don't have a lot of move-outs or a lot of move-ins. Tends to be in the summertime.
Okay.
So at some level, that's predictable, but at the same time, you never know.
But I was watching just on my street alone.
Yeah.
There were no children on our street on Hemlock Lane. Now there are five families.
Yeah, I think anecdotally, if you walk all over town,
I mean,
houses are getting bigger and families are moving in and people are moving out. I think that's where you get that interest in the cottage housing, you know, for the baby boomers and things like that. So
we're growing, no question.
That's the major thing on our docket.
That's amazing. And you've got new lights at Sabourin Field?
Indeed, yep. Next week they'll be
really?
In. They'll be ready to go. They'll be lit up. Yep, absolutely.
Are they energy efficient lights?
They are indeed.
And they're on metal poles, not wooden poles.
And there is a timer system, or how does that
there
work?
There is. I probably, Tasir can probably tell you more about it. But it's all, and maybe even Margot could too, because she's on the energy task force. But,
excuse me.
But it's all within the same the town's vision for energy savings and efficiency.
So are there any other program kinds of things going on that are interesting that the town might not know about and you want to tell us?
No, I mean, I guess I wouldn't say maybe program things, but maybe in the news, the park test. So Bedford last year has been, you remember that state testing that's still happening?
No, I don't remember. I laughed early.
So Bedford last year moved from the MCAS to the park assessment, and it's been a little bit choppy. I think the state has been a little bit hesitant to release many, many park results, because I think that it's a big adjustment from where the MCAS used to work. For example, it's now it's a computer-based test,
right,
which is quite a bit different from the MCAS. So the overall word from the state is that the park results generally fell short of MCAS results. So they've really released general data. The Massachusetts Board of Education in November is going to decide whether or not to adopt park. All 10th graders across the state still took MCAS, so Bedford's one of these towns that's looking at both PARC and MCAS results. So
PARC was done in the spring of last year?
Yeah. Actually, PARC has two times a year. So there's a performance-based in the middle of the year, and then there's an end-of-the-year assessment as well. So it's actually two sessions, two periods.
So there's been nothing at this one. I have a question. Why does it take so long for the results to come out?
That's a great question. I think that the concept of PARC is, at least the design of it is, that's why they have a performance-based and then an end of the year. So the concept is, at least the performance-based results, the teacher can get them back before the end of the year assessment begins. As they're rolling it out, it's not. I think that's a big piece of it, because when we get the results, the children are typically out of our classroom.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, autopsy data. It's only helpful after the fact. So I think that's what we're trying to figure out, you know, about as the state unrolls their plan, how can we use that data? The state's also been hesitant to release too much of the data, so there's only so much we can really go on. But one of the things we know is that the preliminary 10th grade results have been released, and Bedford High School continues to shine. 99% advanced and proficient in ELA, 90% in math, and 87% in science and technology. So Bedford's numbers are still strong, and I think we're feeling happy about it. But we're also looking at what's out there. Is PARC coming? Is PARC staying? A lot of it's going to somewhat depend on that November vote.
Bedford has always been strong, way back to 1969 when I started teaching.
Yep.
And always topped out on everything.
Absolutely.
We got to be proud of that.
One last piece is that Lane School will appear on the opening episode of Ask This Old House on October
7th.
Yes. So make sure you watch that.
Yes. And they dedicated the garden to, is it Gene?
Yep.
Michael?
Yep.
And there is the sweetest little video that you've ever seen, and the promo for the whole season of Ask This Old House.
It's going to be
prominently,
Lane
prominently features the Lane features. School.
Yeah, so October 3rd is the it's actually the season premiere. So Lane School features prominently.
There you go. You will see it here and thrilled, absolutely thrilled. The kids were so cute planting, and you can see them just
getting right in there.
Getting right in there. It was absolutely wonderful.
So was the whole team there?
Say that again. There was a couple students. So there was a student from the school's green team, right. And then other students who either wrote a video, made a video, or had an essay, and then got selected.
And the This Old House team, who was
so there? Roger was there. Roger Cook there. was the landscaper. They were helping build the garden. So, but the whole rest of the crew was there, and it was a long day of filming. I think it was 7 hours of filming.
Oh, it was forever.
It was great.
It was really. It was a big thrill for the kids, though, to be sure. And the result's beautiful if you've seen the garden.
It is. I've seen it too.
It is really good.
So a long history of green in Bedford at schools. So what else? We've got 3 minutes and 32 seconds, 31 seconds. Come on, you guys. There's something else you want to say. What is it?
I have two more items if you're looking for.
Yes.
So one is that the Bedford Public Schools ELL population continues to rise, and that's English language learners. So this year it has climbed to 7.1%. What's different about that is it's a significant number of kindergarten and first graders who are walking in at what we call level one, which is zero English at all. And so Bedford has gotten, and really the entire state of Massachusetts has really caught up to speed on English language learning. And I think Bedford's been an example of that. What we're getting now is increased regulations and increased requirements for ELL students. Compared to the towns that we typically compare ourselves to, I think Bedford's numbers are quite high at 7.1%. So I think that says something that's great about Bedford, and that kids with no English are able to find, you know, a good education, but it also speaks more to what I spoke about last time, which is the ranking, the number five ranking, with, you know, an ELL population higher than a lot of those towns on that top 10 list. Yeah. So I think it's something we're certainly very proud of.
When I taught, we had a Cambodian student come in, didn't know a word of, actually from Laos. He came in, didn't know a word of English, but the students all teamed together to help him get through, and it ended up, he ended up being a pre-med major at University of Massachusetts.
There it is, and I think really that probably has a lot of those stories.
Yeah.
The last item is that Facing History and Ourselves trained 40 peer leaders this week, to talk about differences and to facilitate conversations about differences. We're coming up with a community day later in the fall, and a lot of the professional development and training, both for teachers and students, has been happening through this organization, Facing History and Ourselves. It's just been a great week for that training.
It's been a great week for Bedford.
Absolutely.
It's been a busy week for Bedford.
And for all of these gentlemen and ladies. They've brought us all sorts of fabulous news. Fabulous news. So, we are grateful to you for having spent time with us, but we have a whole another half an hour for you to see. We'll be talking about flavors of Bedford and haunted happenings. So don't leave. Welcome back. We are here with Barb Davis, who is going to tell us about Flavors of Bedford. Have you ever gone to Flavors of Bedford, Ralph?
Yes, I was honored at it when I was Citizen of the Year. I had the primo seat.
There you go. So what did you like best about
It was just being Flavors having all Bedford. The food brought to me and sampling everything.
All right.
But we had to judge in those days, and it was pretty tough decision.
High pressure.
There you go. So Barb, tell us how you got involved in Flavors of Bedford. And who sponsors it, and when it's going to be, and all those wonderful details.
Thank you. Yeah, really We're so excited this year about Flavors because it's going to be the 15th year of Flavors in Bedford.
Oh, really?
And so none of us ever thought that there was going to be anything past the first year, because it's always quite a bit of work to start something new.
But it's been popular ever since it began.
Thank you. The first year, we had everything pulled together, but because it was new, no one knew what Flavors of Bedford was. And we had like 5 tickets sold 2 days before, so we gave away a lot of tickets to volunteers in town the first year. And after that, it's been sold out. So that's one of the secrets of Flavors of Bedford. But this year, instead of the first Sunday, it's going to be November 8th, the second Sunday.
Okay.
And we don't think there's a big football game that day. We're hoping not. But it's
because
the first Sunday was so close to Halloween. But we're very excited. It's going to be at the DoubleTree Bedford Glen Hotel. The grand ballrooms are opened up, and we're very grateful that the DoubleTree will be co-sponsoring with Brown & Brown, private counsel here in town. And Nat and Pam Brown and company have been sponsors for the last several years, so we greatly appreciate their support, and then the commitment from the DoubleTree also. But Flavors of Bedford is comparable to a Taste of the Town, and Burlington just had their Taste of Burlington, or you'll see Taste of Arlington or whatever.
Yeah.
And when it was first started, we felt Bedford is unique. We have many things here, like the ROTC students, that we have an ROTC group at the high school is unique. So we have the cadets come in, and they welcome all of the guests. So you feel very formal and official, and a little bit grand by having the ROTC cadets in uniform welcoming you. But that's a flavor or a characteristic of the town. We try to have local, particularly the Bedford Madrigal Group has performed, different music ensembles from the high school. We've had ensembles from the Lexington Symphony and try to mix it up.
Yeah.
But instead of having a DJ come in, we really try to emphasize what's unique to Bedford, what makes this community diverse, interesting, and what nice surprises do we have in our own town. So that's why it's called Flavors of Bedford. But it's easy to focus on all the delicious tastes and treats that are there.
Well, can we come back to the flavors for just a minute?
Sure.
Because one of the things that I understand is that the money, it's a, you have to buy a ticket. But part of the proceeds goes to the Friends of Hanscom. So isn't it wonderful to have the ROTC kids welcoming you,
mm-hmm.
and then the money comes around and benefits the Hanscom?
A percentage is given to Hanscom every year, and we continue to want to support our community partners at Hanscom, but also the Friends of Hanscom. The money goes to celebrate and support people returning from deployment. And we always invite a number of people, as well as sell tickets at Hanscom, but we try to make sure that many people feel welcome also, and to try to bridge that community with ours. As many people know, the high school kids from Hanscom go to Bedford High School.
And it is an important bridge, because that is an important part of our community.
Yes, yes, it absolutely
part of
is.
Our community.
So many people focus on what's to eat this year.
Well, I was going to be asking that.
Yeah.
Being hungry at being nearly dinner time.
I know, but the flavors of Bedford, when we do an outreach to all the different restaurants, primarily in Bedford, and you're going to see Third Avenue in Burlington well represented, and a number of our extended community partners in Burlington will be joining us. But we're excited that Sora, the main dining room at the DoubleTree Bedford Glen, will be here. And if someone watching has not been to Sora, they're really missing out on a great value. It's close to home. The food is outstanding. Emphasis on Italian, but you can get a great steak there. And you don't have to spend all your time driving.
Well, and Ken Gordon, our state representative, has written a review of Sora, and there are going to be every week in the Bedford Citizen, we'll have one of Ken's restaurant reviews of the flavors restaurants.
Right.
And the first one was about Sora, and I was like, why am I sitting here having a peanut butter sandwich for supper?
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And Bedford Farms will be there as well.
Yeah.
And we're also...
Well, they've been with you a number of years.
From the beginning.
They're everything.
Yeah.
They're good.
I know.
Yeah.
And they're also now opening a new store in Burlington.
Maybe on Monday. Well, though, by the time you see this, they'll already be open.
Right.
Yeah.
So that's exciting. But we're very pleased to share that Bancroft, a very high-end, lovely, lovely steakhouse and more in Burlington on 3rd Avenue, will be joining us this year. Lester's is returning from Burlington. And if any, to repeat all of the restaurants off the top of my head at this point, because it's changing day by day as restaurants commit and we're lining it up. But I would encourage anybody that wants to read the reviews, to look at the restaurants, and as we know what the entrees and the offerings will be, it will be on Flavors of Bedford on Facebook. So somebody could go into Facebook and just search for Flavors of Bedford, and everything will be there. And as you mentioned, Ken Gordon is doing like Phantom Gourmet. reviews. And there are two other individuals. And what we're trying to do is use technology and new approaches to market what we think is just a fabulous event, because a number of us have been going for 10, 12, 14 years.
Yeah.
But it's a great opportunity for people to get together of all ages and go have appetizers, entrees, desserts, a nice glass of wine, and just sit down with friends or family and enjoy yourself. And it's not just for people that like to go out to eat. It might be people that want to gather and have a nice nibble together. We have, we're excited, we have a meetup group from meetup.com coming this year. We're making arrangements for them to come. It's foodies through the internet that want to come and try out our flavors of Bedford instead
How
of Taste of
wonderful.
The Town. So with the, we have a blog and the Phantom Gourmet reviews, and really try to showcase what these outstanding restaurants have to offer. So it will be a fun afternoon. It starts at 4 o'clock. When you get there at noon and start setting up, it's hard to believe that it's going to be a party for about 400 people.
Wow.
But there's plenty of seating. It flows very easily, so people can come and go and get additional helpings. We always take pride in that. We feel like it's kind of a classy event because it's with china and real silverware, not plastic, and you're not trying to balance and whatever.
Oh, good.
Yeah. But that's compliments of the DoubleTree. They really take it to a five-star level.
They take it very seriously, yeah.
Right. So we encourage anybody that is interested in either getting a sitter and coming out or coming out with friends and family at 4 o'clock to 6 o'clock on November 8th and joining us at the DoubleTree just up on Middlesex.
Well, and the other part of all of it is that whether you come by yourself or with a group, there are enough Bedford people there that you are meeting new people, seeing old friends, and it's just, you know, it's the one of when everybody knows your name kind of thing. Absolutely wonderful.
It's absolutely a fun experience. I can remember about 5 years ago, I was at a meeting and they were talking about flavors of Bedford. And they said, well, how's it coming? Because, and they said, oh, Barb Davis is running it. It's going to be good.
Well,
thank
Barb,
you.
Barb Davis and Maureen
Sullivan.
Yeah. And then between the two of them.
But the party
planner is extraordinary.
But the other part from that comment is, that was when it was sort of at this level. Now it's really up at a very high level. It's really much better. You're not just running it. You're making it better every year.
Oh, well, there's a lot of people that participate in that, and I'm much more behind the scenes than I ever was. And Maureen puts me out when she needs me or asks, can you do this or that? And I've had relationships with a number of people professionally in with the Burlington restaurant, so it's nice to share that those connections as well. But the I think it's one of the events that the Burlington Chamber directors get really excited about. And when we ask for volunteers, there's plenty of hands that go up for that one.
Well, so is mine.
There you go. There you go.
So is mine.
But we don't want people to feel left out. It's a reasonable price, and it's a lovely afternoon. And people always come and think, oh, I'll have a taste of everything. And you just cannot taste everything, but you get many good ideas of where you would like to go. And we also have other community partners like Atria Long Meadow, an assisted living community in Burlington participating because of outstanding executive chef and participation each year. So we've got some new people coming on board. We've got the classics that we're thankful for and a number of community partners.
Well, I know where I'm going to be. Will I see you there? You coming too?
I'm sure I'll be there.
I've seen you there many years, Ralph, and you too, Julie. But we appreciate the support through the Bedford Citizen. And spreading through Rotary.
Is there a date? Do they run out of tickets? What's the schedule? Tickets go on sale at the beginning?
You can start to order tickets online through PayPal, and I think you would go in through Facebook to be able to order that or the chamber, and then about 2 weeks before, tickets will go on sale around town, typically at New England Nurseries, at Brookline Bank, a couple of other locations. And then we have never sold out, but we've been at capacity.
Yeah.
So we try not to turn anyone away.
Great.
Yeah.
But the smart money is going to get their tickets early.
Right.
Absolutely.
And for people that come in groups of 8 or more, there's a discount on the tickets. So I would encourage people to check out the Facebook site.
So let's get a bunch of people together. Well, no. Yeah.
There you go.
But it would be fun.
Sure.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah, that's exciting. But I appreciate the opportunity to come and, you know, do a little bit of showcase today about Flavors of Bedford, and hope we see a lot of your audience.
Well, appreciate you coming in. Absolutely.
We do.
Thank you.
The only thing, she could have brought a little snack.
Oh yeah, you could have brought a little pre-flavor.
Well, we're going to have to go to the DoubleTree on November 8th. And that's when we'll get our snacks.
And what time does it start?
Flavor starts at 4 and the bars open at 3:30.
Okay. Sounds good.
Well, there you go. Thanks, Barb. We really appreciate your
Thank
support.
Thank you so much.
Talk
we'll
to
see you soon.
Yep. It's all good. And our guest in this segment of Bedford Common is none other than the magician himself, Carl Winkler, who years ago, when you had lots of teenagers and kids at home,
right,
would decorate his house on, probably don't want to say the address. He would decorate his yard with massive amounts of Halloween stuff. And then when the kids got older, he started bringing it to First Parish. And it's coming back to First Parish this year.
It's coming back, that's right.
So tell us about it.
So on October 23rd and 24th, we're going to be bringing the haunted house back to the Bedford Common at the old meeting house at First Parish. So, 3 floors of frightful fun. Nothing too gory, you know. It's we call it like PG. So there's a lot of very dark things jump out at you, but no blood, nothing like that. You know,
blood, gore, and guts.
A little bit of gore, no guts. Well, a little bit of guts, but no blood. So,
PG guts.
Yes. So it's a lot of fun. It's one of these things where you walk through the entire building. It takes about 30-40 minutes to do that. And then at the end, we have an area with games and food that you can buy, you know, things. So.
And so is it for all ages?
Yes, it is. Well, we have two different things set up. So it's really for older kids and families in the evenings, Friday nights, 6 to 10 p.m. and Saturday night, 6 to 10 p.m. But then at 11:30 in the morning on Saturday morning until about 3 o'clock, we have what's called trick or treat, where little kids can come in dressed as in costume, and they get to walk through the whole building in the light with, you know, not scary music.
Yeah.
And then there's wonderful wizards and.
I did that one year, and gosh, it was fun.
Yeah, and so the kids then aren't so scared, and they'll actually say, "I want to come back." And so we end up seeing half of them coming back
at night,
you know.
Well, hey, listen,
so it works out
double dip
well.
Is always a good thing.
Right.
So is there a theme this year?
So every year we always have a theme. And so as not to be sued, we're very careful about what our themes are moving forward.
Okay.
So this year's theme is the Bedford Alchemist Society, a secret society here in Bedford that are finally opening their doors so that you can see what they do.
Oh.
So you'll have the opportunity to see the Vault of Mysteries. You'll be able to go in and experience a seance in 4D.
Four?
Yeah, 4D.
What is
3.
The fourth D?
Basically getting the stuffing scared out of you. So that's the, and then we have a scientist who's on duty there to kind of show you what he's working on. And a scary walkthrough at the end that you can choose to go into or not. So it's the idea is you get to that point, they'll warn you that it's very, you know, startling, and you can bypass that if you want.
We
also have a few carnivorous plants.
Oh, they're always
you know,
fun.
So that'll
do they come out and go?
Well, I don't want to ruin the surprise, Julie.
Oh, yeah,
Come on.
Can we bring the cameras? No.
Oh, I'd love that.
Cameras are okay.
Yeah, absolutely.
And what? Bedford kind of needs to know is that Carl does this not single-handedly, from scratch.
So it takes about a year to do, and I have a great, an amazing team of creative people. I couldn't do this by myself. And this year we really collected a huge group. You know, I think there's 9 of us all together. And what happens is I usually come up with a theme, and I bring them in, and they figure out how to make everything.
So each one takes responsibility.
Takes a section, right. We
okay.
have, Cynthia, who does all of the set design. She can take, go into a room with a tablecloth and a couple of jars and leave, and it'll look like some, you know, crazy laboratory.
So. Okay, this is Cynthia Mork we're talking about, a Bedford resident. That's okay. Well, we got to give props out there because she is good.
Now,
she
is that part of their background? Did they used to do that?
Well, I told her she missed her calling as a set designer. Because, I mean, it's just amazing what she can do. And then Peter Waskoff, also a Bedford resident, who to this day does a haunted driveway at his parents' house here in Bedford. I wish I knew the name of the website because you can actually go and see. But he does all sorts of animatronics and lighting and, you know, he has ghosts, you know, flying through the air.
Really?
It's quite amazing. You know? And so finally this year he agreed to help us out. So I'm really looking forward to seeing
what he does. Isn't he your neighbor?
Yeah, he lives right down the street from us.
Yeah, all right. So. Now we know where it is. So we check the website.
So is it an area or town we ought to go trick-or-treating in?
It was funny.
You don't have to give the direct way.
Right. At Bedford Day, we were truly surprised at how many people remembered the haunted house.
Oh.
And we had one woman who actually walked through every year the progression of each theme. And I was like, wow, I had no idea that people would remember it to that level.
It's a pretty impressive achievement.
How many years is this going on?
It went on for about 6 years, I think. It was much smaller, and then it grew for 4 years. It was really big to the point it was just too much. Because we kept growing it. And the staff didn't get any bigger. So, we've figured out a different way of doing it so that it's going to be, I think, just as exciting, but not,
as intensive for the staff.
So the experience at the first parish is kind of like also a preview for the real night of horror and
that's
terror.
That's right. Absolutely.
Can we give a hint as to where the neighborhood is that we might want to...
Sure, it's off of... Okay, so the neighborhood where you have to go is Ledgewood.
Ledgewood Drive, okay.
Right. And then Springs Road.
And Springs Road has a phenomenal setup there as well. So those are two places that are just, it's great.
Yeah, right across... on Springs Road just after the turn, before you go down to go
on the way down the hill.
Right. Yeah.
And, it's been something that... Now that my son, who is really into it, has grown up and has moved on, it's nice to be able to continue it as a hobby at First Parish.
Will he come back to
what? He can't. This is his senior year. He's doing his, presentation, so he can't really take the time.
So can you tell me about this artifact?
This lovely thing. Okay, so last Halloween when we decided we're going to do it, on the 1st of November, I bought it at CVS for $2, and it was chattering teeth. And so what we did, this is called kit bashing, where you actually take the original kind of hokey thing and you add to it to make it unique. So we have a bunch of these that you'll see throughout. You'll actually see one that's still the chattering teeth, but you'll see the eyes. There's one that's an
ear.
This
one looks like eyeballs.
This one is just eyeballs.
Or a squid.
No, take a look closer.
Squid.
Well, I know they're the eyeballs.
Those are they're going. He's the one down here near the bottom too. So,
they're all over the place.
This is the type of thing that that the team will take things and either repurpose or make them better than what they were.
Hey, that's a great idea.
Yeah, and that's a chess piece on the top just to give it a little more of a fancy look.
Well, and it kind of looks like Minerva from.
Exactly. So that's the idea, and the whole point of this event is take your time walking through it, see everything.
Photographs allowed?
Yes, actually. They are at the end, not before, because things go on. It is truly three floors. You start off in the lower level where you come in and purchase your ticket. There's some things that happen down there. And we have a wonderful group of actors from the floor, from the lower level to the second floor.
Great.
That year after year I say, we're doing it, and they're like, I want more lines.
And then there are the kids of First Parish.
Right.
And local kids from the community.
So the one of the events is actually written by, kids here in Bedford. The teenagers are going to be performing it, basically a retelling of The Mask of the Red Death, if you're familiar with Edgar Allan Poe. So, we have younger kids that are actually guides that keep the groups together as they go through.
Tour guides coming through.
Right.
Oh, great.
So, and that gives them the chance, especially for the younger kids, to participate and help out. And it's great because, I was filling out the sign-up sheets for it and, trying to give the categories, you could be 8 to 80, helping out with this thing.
So the guides in costume, too, they really?
Yes. This year they're all wearing red.
Oh, okay.
This is our...
Yeah, the last time they all had had like painter's suits or hazmat suits.
Hazmat suits.
Oh,
yeah. We did a matter matter conveyor. So basically you beam from one location to the other. And there's some issues with that.
Are these signs going to be around town?
Yes, you'll see these signs. Not as well as the Apple Fest happening this weekend, but you'll see.
Yeah, well, sadly.
Oh, this is going to be taped after.
This won't be shown to the Apple Fest.
Tried to give them a plug in.
Yeah. There you go. So, they deserve it.
They sure do.
So if you had one thing that you wanted to tell the community about Haunted House, what would it be? The one thing we might not have asked you.
So we always find that the older kids don't want to do it. Unless they're brought with their parents, you know, teenagers and high schoolers, and yet the ones that do go through seem to have a great time. So it's kind of, I know it's not Witch's Woods or any of these really gory places.
But it's here in Bedford.
But it's here in Bedford.
Yeah.
It's much cheaper than those, and it's a lot of fun, you know, and that's the one piece we've never seemed to be able to get over that hurdle.
It'd be a great high school date.
Oh, absolutely. And this year especially, because it's very dark.
Oh!
So you're going to have, no, never mind. Shining the light.
No.
Oh, this will be good.
Yeah.
It is good. Carl, thank you so much for
Carl,
conjuring
so
it
much.
And for coming and telling us about it.
Absolutely. Yep. Absolutely. Thank you.
You're
great.
Welcome. Thank you for coming. Thank you very much, Bedford, for joining us for our October, I was going to say Oktoberfest, but we haven't really been talking about drinking. It is, though,
October spook.
A spook time. And we'll be back in November, and thank you so much for joining us. Ralph, will you come back in November?
I absolutely will be back in November. All right.
And maybe you can come back and tell us how the Haunted House
Oh, yeah, we
works.
Have okay, a recap
sure.
and some ideas for next year.
Yes.
There you go.
Okay, thanks for coming.
Good night, Bedford.